Our theme this week is that this is the most important week in the history of the world. And it most certainly is. So I'm doing extra videos and some shorter ones here to get everyone up to speed so they understand the context of what's going on in the world, because it's going to happen very fast and it's happening right now. We spoke last video about the sustainability goal. Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations, and how the Pope is here really to push that agenda, and the Pope and the President are going to push this agenda through. So we need to get up to speed on this a little bit, and to help us out with this, I'm going to shift over to a graphic here, and we'll get through this rather quickly. All right, we won't get stuck in anything. This is a graphic of the UN website. It's www.un.org/sustainable development goals. Okay, sustainable development goals. So, in this graphic, we see 17 different icons. And if I can go over these with you, let me see. The web page is kind of getting a little bit stuck. And so these 17 goals are the goals that they are going to focus on. The United Nations, not the United Nations, the entire planet. Their idea is everybody on this planet, everyone on this planet is supposed to, in their eyes, make these 17 goals their own 17 goals and prioritize these, give these top priority. And this is for the next 15 years. By the year 2030, they expect to have succeeded with these various goals. So the first one in red there to the left, top left, no poverty. Okay, so goal number one, no more poverty. They're going to get rid of poverty. They're going to get rid of spiritual poverty, such as ignorance in the option to choose to set down pretense, spiritual pretense, stop pretending to be human, stop pretending to be in a world, stop pretending to be time, space, and process and form. Are they going to end spiritual poverty? They don't mention that here, do they? They say just no poverty. Okay, number two, zero hunger. Zero hunger. How about the hunger for spiritual truth? Are they going to feed us with the bread of life that Jesus talks about, right teachings, right practice, right clarification, listen to the Holy Spirit, and get rid of our spiritual hunger? Or is it just zero hunger, just food, materialism, in other words, just materialistic viewpoint? Sounds like they're talking about materialistic viewpoint here. No poverty, no zero hunger. Good health and well-being. Good health. How about spiritual health and spiritual well-being, which is to realize that all sickness is merely pretending. Spirit is simply pretending to be sick, pretending to age, pretending to die, pretending to be ill. Are they going to enlighten us on all this? Is this their goal? Doesn't seem like it, huh? How about quality? Number four, quality education. Well, are they going to educate us about truth here, about the options we have? Either try to make pretense permanent and educate us that that's impossible, or to gently set down our pretense, which is absolutely possible and doable and the best option. Are they going to educate us about truth here? Ours is just reading, writing, arithmetic, science, you know, like that. Gender equality, they always love that one. Okay, well, that's great. Are they going to finally find some way for men to get some sort of equality with women? Really? I mean, real equality, not just pretend equality that suits the purpose of women? Or is it men good? No, I don't. They don't say that. I see they seem to be indicating that women are these like inherent underdogs, which is absolutely not true at all. So I really doubt that they have that in mind when they talk about gender equality. Clean water and sanitation. Well, that's very laudable. All right. How about mental sanitation, mental cleanliness, spiritual sanitation? Are they going to allow all sorts of ugly, you know, ugly materialistic false premise propaganda in the world as they do now? They don't seem to be mentioning that. They don't seem to be cleaning up all of the propaganda and brainwashing and marketing that's taking place in this world. They might want to sanitize that. Affordable and clean energy. Okay. affordable and clean energy. Yeah, we'd like everyone to be affordable, clean energy. That would be really nice. Decent work and economic growth. Okay, decent work and economic growth. Number 9, industry, innovation, and infrastructure. So industry, innovation, and infrastructure. How about the spiritual infrastructure of this planet? How about that? How about building a planet where we spend the majority of our time in contemplation and right spiritual practice and in affirmation, full stop on the wow, flipping the script, evaporating our continuity fear. That I don't think they mean that, though. 10, reduced inequalities. So they want everybody to be equal. Sounds like a utopia, inequality of the flesh, instead of teaching the fact that we all have perfect standing with God in reality as absolute, immaculately flawless, perfect spirit, perfectly free to play, entertain all ideas and experiencing endlessly. I don't think they mean that sort of equality. I think they sort of mean some sort of quota situation, and well, we know how that goes. 11, sustainable cities and communities. Sustainable cities and communities. How about, they're talking about monastic communities and spiritual communities here? I don't think they are, actually. Number 12, responsible consumption and production. Responsible consumption and production. Okay, very nice. Number 13, climate action. Climate action, that's a big one. Number 13, climate action. They have people believing that they're all going to die real soon. You talk about the ultimate doomsdayers. Is the climate change people are the biggest fear mongers in history. They're all going to be dead. We're all going to die. You know, the climate change is going to kill everybody. So this is a big one. They want to keep it. And notice the graphic is this eye. They want to keep an eye on everybody. It's very symbolic here. This eye, they put it, the world in this eye shape, you see, like a pupil, like an eyeball in an eye. So they want to keep an eye on every last little thing that we do, to regulate everything so they can avoid the doomsday of this climate change. This is somehow going to swamp the whole world. 14, life below water. Okay, great. Yeah, absolutely. We want our oceans to be clean and respect the life below water, life on land. Well, these are feel-good things, life on land. How about spiritual life? Do they, let me see, is that in here somewhere? The fish, and is that a Christian fish? Not really, so I'm not sure that they mean they've gotten to the, how about life beyond, life above pretense? Life below water, life on land, how about life above pretense? No, they're not focusing on that one. Number 16, for the blue one, peace, justice, and strong institutions. Peace, what? Peace, what? Peace, what? I mean, peace of mind. They haven't seemed to have followed a single initiative here, a goal which has anything to do with finding peace of mind, choosing peace of mind, actually choosing peace of mind. Justice, well, no peace, no justice, right? I mean, what is justice except for us to accept the justice of God, which is that we all have perfect standing in God, which can never be changed no matter what we do. That's justice. Are they talking about that? I don't think so. And strong institutions. Well, how about this climate change eye? You know, a global institution to make sure that everyone follows these goals. Probably what they're thinking about here. And partnerships for the goals. Oh, they have all these interlocking circles forming this little flower in the middle. How cool. The partnerships for the goals. Well, how about a global partnership where everybody's on board and they make sure that these are the goals that everybody follows and don't deviate from these. So this is our roadmap. They've laid out, they paved. I've been talking about in videos about how our expectations pave the road that we travel down, which we call our future. We travel into the future along a road of our expectations. Well, these are the expectations of the United Nations and the leaders of every country on the planet, and including the Pope. They expect you to go down this, you know, yellow brick road here. the Sustainable Development Goal Road. Okay, with all these nice colorful pavers here. Then they have a little spiel here about a little talk here. On September 25th, countries will have the opportunity to adopt a set of global goals to end poverty. How about spiritual poverty? I don't think they talked about that. Protect the planet. How about protecting us from the planet, which is just an attempt to distract ourselves from the truth? How about helping us protect ourselves from our projections, which is what the planet is, from our pretense? Protect us from the planet. Liberate us from the planet. Or set the planet free from our projections. I don't think they're going to get around to that by 2030. Don't think they're going to get there by 2030. And ensure the prosperity for all. What kind of prosperity? Material prosperity? How about spiritual clarity? Are they talking about that, or that's not quite on their goal list for 2030, is it? So, ensure prosperity for all. Ensure. How do you ensure prosperity for all in a materialistic way like this? Hasn't God already ensured prosperity for us by the truth of what we are? And aren't we trying to throw that away by pretending we're something else? And as long as we're trying to pretend that we're something else, aren't we going to feel that we're not, don't have true prosperity? Yeah. Okay. Ensure prosperity for all as part of a new sustainable development agenda. SDA, the new sustainable development agenda. Hello, 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 hello. Okay, we've been talking about a new world order that has an agenda for us, a road that we're supposed to travel down. Here it is, you're looking at it right now. So the cat is out of the bag. Each goal has specific targets to be achieved over the next 15 years. Each goal has specific targets to be achieved over the next 15 years. So they have already paved the road for the next 15 years, and they're going to have global targets, and we're going to be targeting those, as well as targeting those who are dragging their feet towards these targets, right? For the goals to be reached, listen to this, for the goals to be reached, everyone needs to do their part. Did you get that? This is right on the United Nations website. For the goals to be reached, everyone needs to do their part. You don't think this is going to be taught in schools to the kids? Governments, comma, the private sector, comma, civil society, and people like you. They love to use this term, civil society, as if you don't subscribe to these goals, you're somehow uncivil. Uncivil. Well, we brought up a whole bunch of questions about these goals, really pointing out that these goals themselves are highly uncivil and highly detrimental to our spiritual welfare, extremely distracting, extracting us away from what our true goals should be. And so that would be most uncivil, wouldn't it? So this sustainable development agenda itself is extraordinarily uncivil, pinning us in to this extremely bad option of trying to make pretense permanent and believe that it is reality. Very uncivil. So do you want to get involved? You can start by telling everyone about them. So for the goals to be reached, everyone needs to do their part, government, the private sector, and society, and people like you. Do you want to get involved? You can start by telling everyone about, well, we're telling everyone about these goals, and we're saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, I think they're forgetting us, spirit, what we are. They're taking us to be human, which is the greatest mistake that anyone can possibly make. So there you have it. Sustainable Development Goals, United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And every one of these goals has specific targets. Okay. So we go to goal 5. That's the sustainable gender equality. What was that goal? Goal 5. Achieve gender equality. Okay. Gender equality. What the heck does that mean? Does that mean men are going to be having babies? I guess that's what it means. Okay, but there's a catch to this. Number five, achieve gender equality. And when you click on it, it takes you to a page where it shows the specific target. So get this. It says achieve gender equality. This is the heading, title. And this is the and that they didn't show you before, which I assume I'm right. And empower all women and girls. Empower all women and girls. Empower them how? They're already empowered. They already have more power than men. Should they choose to use it? Women and girls should be taught is you restrain yourself from using your empowerment that you have over men, so you don't crush them and emasculate them and crush them and turn men into just the weak figures that you see in the world right now. Extremely weak men, extraordinarily weak men. So women have to show restraint because innate nature, the way things are set up, they have the power to call the shots. So they're saying achieve gender equality. I thought they might say empower all boys and men to be able to stand up to the modern feminist women. But no, it's empower all women and girls. So there you have it. Pretty cut and dry. Okay, so facts and figures. And they want to goal five targets. They want to empower women to get into politics and leadership, etc. They already lead or already dominate the home and the social sphere. So end all forms of discrimination against all women and girls everywhere. Wait a minute, how about discrimination against men? It wants some equality? Is this really a fair goal that we have? Shouldn't we be talking about everyone? I mean, men aren't discriminated against as wage slaves. They die. Men live on average 7 years less than women. How about that inequality? Eliminate all forms of violence against women and girls in public and private spheres, including trafficking and sexual and other types of exploitation. Okay. Well, how about all the microaggression against men by the way that women dress and present themselves? Massive microaggression against men. I don't know if they're going to mention that. Eliminate all harmful practices, such as child, early and forced marriage, and female genital mutilation. Okay, well, these are cultural, social things that for various reasons, cultures practice this. Okay, this is something that is debatable, and we'll go on to the next one. Recognize and value unpaid care and domestic work through the provision of public services, infrastructure, and social protection policies, and the promotion of shared responsibility within the household and family as nationally appropriate. Shared responsibility. Well, the man's out trying to cater to women's materialistic lusts and vanities, working himself to death. Are they going to address that? Are women going to be paving roads and patching roads and doing all the hard, dangerous labor? I don't think so. How about equality in dangerous labor? How many men get killed in industrial accidents and dangerous work throughout history, you know? Well, uncountable numbers. How about women doing that? Oh, no, the women are different. They have children. Okay, so they're different. Oh, they're different. They can't do that. So it's not really equality, is it? Okay. Ensure women's full and effective participation, equal opportunities for leadership at all levels of decision-making in political, economic, and public life. They already basically call the shots and always have behind the scenes. Ensure universal access to sexual reproductive health and reproductive rights is agreed in accordance with the Program of Action in the International Conference of Population and Development and the Beijing Platform for Action and the outcome document of the review. Okay, so some of these things are helpful. Undertake reforms, but it only talks about women. It seems to be extremely biased and sexist here, excluding men in this whole talk about equality. I can bring up 100 items that men are absolutely on the worst, on the bad side of equality situation. Terrible. And they don't even make one reference to this. Undertake reforms to give women equal rights to economic resources. Well, I mean, don't they do most of the buying decisions around the world? Certainly United States, I think that, what is it, about a huge percentage of all purchase decisions are made by women, which is why the corporations are marketing women so severely, because they know they can advertise to them, and they're very susceptible and agreeable to various advertising and marketing campaigns. So ownership and control over land and other forms of property, financial services, inheritance, and natural resources in accordance with national laws. Okay, this is just trying to, just trying to make a whole bunch of change, not respecting many, many, many other factors. Extraordinarily taking things out of context. Enhance the use of enabling technology, in particular information and communication technology, to promote the empowerment of women. Adopt and strengthen sound policies and enforceable legislation for the promotion of gender equality and the empowerment of all women and girls at all levels. Okay, what about just the natural differences? Many, 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 many differences, okay, in many ways. Oh, so anyway, this is the most severe propaganda inequality statements I've ever read in my life. Okay, number five. Probably a statement of the most severe inequality I've ever come across. And they're calling this equality. Where are all the points on men? Their rights. You never hear a word about it. How about protection from sexual aggression from women in the way that they, the body language they use, all sorts of ways that women target men sexually and try to seduce them and distract them, etc. Not a word about that. Not a word about that. Pull them into having children with them and force them then to work for the rest of their lives, supporting the children that may not even wanted to be pulled into that. On and on and on. This is hardly a balanced presentation that they're doing, Hardly a balanced presentation. In fact, this is the most imbalanced thing I've ever seen. Girls' rights are a priority, says UN chief and UNFPA head. Okay. This is the headline. Girls' rights are a priority. How about boys' rights? Boys suffer from way more developmental problems. In school, girls dominate the boys. Okay. Boys are turned into very sort of robotic, frightened, withdrawn kids. I know there's a terrible difficulty a lot of boys have growing up. Not a word here. Not a word. What is this organization that calls themselves the United Nations? How about the unfair nations? Unequal nations. The unequal nations. So this sounds like a Faustian nightmare, okay, that they're talking about here. It's incredible. I thought somebody would finally stand up for men here who have just been crushed by corporate dominance here. And I can say my whole life here, all I've heard is that men are terrible, men are bad, men are evil, they're responsible for all the problems of the world. If you just put women in charge, everything will be fine, which we know is an absolute lie, absolute deceit. In fact, men have done the lion's share of the work in bringing to light the Holy Spirit, bringing to light the gospel of truth, bringing to light the way to be saved from pretense. And not a peep of it from this wretched organization we call the United Nations. Wow, that is just unbelievable what they just said there. Gender equality, this double speak. Again, the genders have different roles. I mean, you don't see, if you have a family, you don't like forcing girls to dress up and wear makeup. No, they do it on their own. They do it on their own, and guys are out there, getting cut and bleeding and working hard, and you see them going to construction, working their rear ends off, dusty, filthy, dirty, very dangerous, difficult jobs. This is what guys do. Guys not supposed to complain. Go out there and earn, so the wife can buy, and these are the roles, that the traditional roles. They're saying let's get rid of traditional roles. Okay, but how about getting rid of men's traditional roles, where the women go out and do all the hard work and the men get the money and buy? I don't think they're talking about that. So that's just one thing. Climate action. So see, all this stuff is needs to be looked at much more closely. They're being extreme ideologue, extremely biased ideologues here, whereas we're just pointing out, hey, there's other sides to it. You look at things within the context of spiritual practice. If you don't look at it that way, it's going to become drastically distorted. Okay, climate change goals, 13 targets. It's goal 13, it has 13 targets. Oh, I see each goal has the same number of targets, I think. How cute. Okay, let me see here. 13 targets. I'm doing this on the website as you're listening. Strengthen. Okay. Now they don't give all 13 targets. Strengthen resilience. Okay, it gets all technical here. On climate change thing. Strengthen resilience and adaptive capacity to climate-related hazards and natural disasters in all countries. Integrate climate change measures into national policies. Oh, integrate climate change measures into national policies, strategies, and planning. Improve education, awareness raising, and human and institutional capacity on climate change, mitigation, adaptation, impact reduction, and early warning. Implement the commitment undertaken by developed country parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change to a goal of mobilizing jointly $100 billion annually by 2020 from all sources to address the needs of developing countries in the context of meaningful mitigation actions and transparency on implementation and fully operational the Green Climate Fund through its capitalization as soon as possible. Promote mechanisms for raising capacity for effective climate change related planning and management in least developed countries and small island developing states, including focusing on women, youth, and local and marginalized communities. Okay, so pretty sort of basic and generalized there, but it could mean a lot. But this is really the Pope and the President is there. They say this is the top priority. Okay, fine. That's their top priority. How about spiritual liberation as a top priority here? See, this is all out of whack. You see, what I'm saying is not that there's isn't some laudableness to some of these things, you know, clean water and sanitation and all that stuff. Sure, but it's the totally distorted, out of context, blinding us to our higher calling. We should have 17 other goals, which are vastly superior and more important to these goals. And yet they're saying that these goals are the most important goals in the world. This is grotesque, absolutely grotesque. Reduced inequalities, that will be, you know, third world people and stuff and hunger. So there you go. Partnership for the goals. I wonder if they're going to have 17. That's the last one, 17. Revitalize the global partnership for sustainable development. Yeah, goal 17 targets. Okay, they don't have actually 17. Just a, there's a lot of them. Finance, strengthen domestic resource finance, developed countries, mobilize additional finance. So technology, capacity building, trade. Promote a universal, rules-based, open, non-discriminatory, and equitable multilateral trading system under the World Trade Organization, including through the conclusion of negotiating under the Doha Development Agency. Systemic issues. Okay. Financial. Okay, so sort of wide-ranging talk. Alrighty, very great. So we've gotten to take a look at this, and we understand that this is an extraordinarily 100% humanistic agenda, leaning heavily to the belief in the superiority of women and their capacity. They need to be brought into authoritative decision making roles in every possible way. Because this is what humanism is believing right now, that the roots of humanism in the modern times is based on feminism, radical feminism, which believes that women inherently know how to be at peace, develop peaceful civilizations, be peaceful relationships, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And anybody who knows anything about human society knows that is just absolute rubbish. Okay, it's very superficial. It's a very superficial way of looking at the situation, based on sort of maternal instinct and traditional roles of women, etc. But if you take a look at the aristocratic women, which I have a lot of experience with in a previous life, they are extraordinarily wicked and extraordinarily vain and egotistical, and in fact, you give any woman in this world all sorts of power, and it goes to their head, and they become power crazy, and just like men. I mean, they're no better at all, but the fact they can cover it up better makes them even worse in those capacities. So it's a disaster, what they're thinking. And then you get into the big mother, total monitoring, the nanny state, you know, which is, so the UN has simply put their cards on the table, and we're looking at their cards here, and it's exactly what the Holy Spirit has told me, exactly so. And again, there's a lot of things to say, like life below the water, etc., and we're not disagreeing with a lot of these goals as just, these are feel good nice things, etc., you know, okay, fine, that's great, energy, etc., but what we're saying is that this is this complete exclusion, unbelievably biased exclusion of spiritual goals, and extremely sexist exclusion of promoting men and boys' health. You know, boys have hideous difficulties now. They're completely left out. This has been going on for last 30 years or 40 years, actually. It's just astonishing. They're being turned into slaves. Men are being turned into slaves, plain and simple. Not a word about that. Not a word about it. So, incredibly sexist organization. Biased, unequal, promoting inequality, promoting dominance, and on and on and on and on. So, the criticisms here are just massive of what's going on in here. So this is the agenda that the Pope is promoting. Okay, this is the agenda that the Pope is there to address the United Nations. This is the Sustainable Development Goal Assembly of the General Assembly of the United Nations, starting on September 25th, and on the morning of September 25th, I think about 11 a.m. in the morning or something, the Pope is going to address all the members of the United Nations. The Pope is going to address them. And he's made it very clear that he shares all these goals. Very, very clear. That this is, and he wants the church to put these goals first. He said, actually, the number one goal of the church is climate change, is to combat. He's putting a secular, humanistic, sexist, biased agenda as the mission of the church, and in claiming that Jesus, this is what Jesus wants. Well, I can tell you, it is nothing at all that Jesus wants in terms of priority, in terms of importance. So, anti-pope, you know, the anti-pope. Which we're told this would happen, and it has happened. And of course, the president, who has no past apparently, also is on board with all this stuff and a lot more. Especially as long as he can be, the dictator who can be on the top of all this one world bureaucracy, administering all these goals. they're working on that frantically. Say, well, how can we get all these goals? We need somebody to head this up. What about Bill Clinton? Well, Bill's a little too busy, you know, padding his bankroll. So, you know, oh, this president here, oh, perfect, perfect fit. Let's make him chief, chief administrator of the planet, something like that. So, you know, our eyes are wide open here. And we're just looking at this, just saying, wow, 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 wow. Letting it sink in. This is your United Nations. This is what you're supposed to buy into for your life. This is supposed to be your life. And like I said, I actually put down 100 things that they completely avoided, which are way more important than any of these things. That are you know, your life. Your life. I'm not going to do it and make fools out of them, of course. But you know darn well what we're talking about here. And what is truly important for our life? What's truly important for our life, that there's absolutely nothing here in this world that even remotely reminds us or has anything to do with what we truly are at all. This is, it's come straight from Jesus Christ. There's absolutely nothing here to value, because all this is an attempt to define what we are, and since we're perfect freedom, we cannot be defined. cannot be defined at all. There's nothing that appears in our experiencing that we cannot drop instantly and pick anything else up instantly. So nothing has a hold on us at all. So how can we be defined in any which way? So you could bring up these true goals. The true responsibility of humans is to realize they're not human, that they're spirit. Okay, so you know, so these goals are really goals of severe irresponsibility by the United Nations. The United Nations is a worldwide body which is dedicated to extreme irresponsibility. Hideous, grotesque, you know, whimsical irresponsibility to completely avoid what our real responsibility is. And that the Pope, who's supposed to be standing for 1.2 billion people's spiritual welfare, shepherding them into eternal life, is going to be promoting this? I suppose this is what he's there. Or is he going to condemn all of it? I don't think he's going to condemn all of it. He hasn't given the slightest indication that he's anything but a super rah-rah booster of all this stuff. Well, he's supposed to be shepherding people's highest spiritual goals, which is eternal life, which is what we were created as, and we still are. We're just pretending to not be. And he's supposed to say, look, you're supposed to put your attention on this. And of course, by putting our attention on this, all these other goals will be pretty well taken care of in a lot of ways. Because your life will be very simple, your carbon footprint will be extraordinarily small. You'll be very humble. I mean, you just go right over all these goals. You know, and when you live in great simplicity, you know, it's poverty, as far as poverty goes. Well, you wouldn't be having many children in the first place, if any. You cut down the number of people. You live very simply. Zero hunger. Well, yeah, we don't want hunger, but we've got so many people. There's a great struggle for all these resources, and you know, good health and well-being. Well, if you're living a Holy Spirit-centered life, you're going to get along okay. Good education. Well, we'll have, you know, best teachers in the world teaching what is truly important. What's our true responsibility? So we'd have fabulous education. And we wouldn't waste all our time on miseducation. And gender equality, absolutely. We'd promote spiritual truth for men and women equally, as we're doing here. I'm sharing truth here without controlling whoever watches the videos at all. Right? Everything here is given to everybody. So there would be no inequality whatsoever in that regard. There would be pragmatic steps, of course. So you don't have the natural distraction mechanism, attraction mechanism that's going on there and disrupting. You wouldn't allow disruption to take place. Clean water and sanitation. Well, yeah, I'm sure everyone would work for that very much. So clean energy. Well, I mean, we live so simply, you wouldn't need much energy. It's easy to reach that. Decent work and economic growth. Again, you wouldn't really be worried about building up. You wouldn't be an economic animal, a materialist at all. So you wouldn't need some extreme, you know, resource-depleting economy at all. And on and on. Okay, reduced inequalities. Well, of course, if everybody is working toward being responsible, everyone be getting along and respecting one another. It'd be this great respect in the world. And they sort of left this out. Climate action, well, it would vastly help the climate. In fact, it would solve the problem. Life below water, of course, we would respect that. Life of land, of course, respect that. Justice and peace, of course, everyone would have great respect for one another and that they're being responsible. So the UN just completely drops the ball on all of this. Completely drops the ball. And these are supposed to be the genius leaders of this world. And, you know, like I said, women have enormous power right now. One woman walks into a room, she can control the whole room if she's of a certain personality type. And you see the handprints of the goddess, the mother goddess, all over this agenda. All over this agenda. I don't hear any men, the voice of men here at all, I'll tell you the truth. men look at things a little differently, and they're a little more courageous of speaking up. They'll stand up for the gospel. They tend to be more courageous and risk-taking. I don't see any risk-taking here at all. This is just all real cautious, feel-good stuff I think everybody can get on board with this. No guts, no glory here, to say the least. So, very much a feminist manifesto here, as you would expect, and as number five proved, that it's just an extraordinarily feminist viewpoint here. Unbelievably vicious towards men by just leaving them out of the conversation entirely. You know, go away, boys. You know, don't you have some work to do, and build us a better house. You know, I'm sure you got some work to do to make our lives more comfortable. Run along now, boys, you know. So what if you die 7 years earlier and are sick a lot more? And basically never go to doctors and don't complain and just, you know, not supposed to complain. It's pain, keep working, doesn't matter. You know, run along, boys. So, yeah, great. Love this institution, huh? The United Nations, wow. I haven't really paid any attention to it up till now, but the Holy Spirit said, take a look at it. And see what you see. And so I look at it and say, wow, that's not very nice. Not really being very nice or helpful. How many homeless, you know, people, you take a homeless people, well, majority are men. Huge majority are men. Society takes care of women as best they can. You know, they do very good. But men, you're out of luck. You're out of luck. Now, there's differences around the world, of course. We all understand this. They're not being unreasonable. There are inequalities that need to be worked out, of course. But it needs to be understood. But this is not... this is an extraordinarily feminist manifesto here. They haven't. They don't show any willingness to give men a fair shake at all. You're just supposed to implement. We'll just go along like good little boys with this. Well, guess what? We are going along like good little boys and girls with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's plan for true peace of mind, for true equality. That's where you find the equalities, the quality of spirit. There's no equality of the flesh at all. The pursuing the quality of flesh is a utopian dystopianness. It's a utopian dystopian nightmare that the UN is trying to get towards. How about the fear that men, that young boys live in high school? I've talked to of young men in high school. They say we live in terror of women here because they're so aggressive, they're so pushy, they're so quick to condemn us, and if we say anything they don't like, they're so quick to accuse us, you know, and ruin our reputation and put us down, and you know, we can get in big trouble, easily get in big trouble. And it's just, as boys being boys, boys are different than girls growing up. Everybody knows that. They're more aggressive, they're more risk-taking, you know, very much so. For really dangerous stuff, they're more pioneering. This is the way it is in nature. You see the male bird hops down on the ground first, and the female bird's up in the tree still looking around. The male checks to see if there's any danger around. Then once it's determined there's no danger, then the female bird comes down and starts feeding. Okay. This is how it is. And, you know, it's a tough go, but men have to basically face danger, threats to their well-being, and try to clear those dangers out and make a nice, civilized place so the women and children can be raised, and that's the way it is. And that's how it is, you know. So, but no, not a word of this by the United Nations. This is an extraordinarily biased organization. Extreme bias, you might say. Wow. And every leader of every country in the world is signing off on this. I hope this didn't stop, but it might have. Anyway, so at least, you know, whatever your beliefs are on this, I'm sure everybody believes certain different ways about different things, which is fine. That's understood. Everyone has a unique perspective here. At least you're aware of this now, and you might be saying, huh, I don't know if I really want to have the United Nations in control of my life. Even if the Pope and the President say, this is, we know that this is what's best. Because I think I'm hearing a different perspective here, that it's not for my best at all. There's something way better for me that I deserve. I absolutely deserve it. 100% deserve to stop pretending that I'm something different than I really am. Even God deserves that, you know? Doesn't God deserve for us to stop pretending that we're something different than what God created us as? I would say so. God deserves that. So why are we trying to shortchange God and trying to shortchange ourselves? So we have the option to stop doing that. And there's not a speck, not an iota of recognition of this in the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. Not even the tiniest, 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 tiniest infinitesimal speck of acknowledging this, respecting it, promoting it. Not a trace. So you want, who wants to have their life next 15 years now? There'll be another 15-year period which pushes these even more. Another one's secular humanism even more. So this is the secular humanist manifesto right here, which is going to be officially set in stone on the 25th of September, which is why the Holy Spirit has been telling me September is super, super important. And especially this week of September. Now, we've also talked about how the Pope, we'll talk about this a little bit, wants to get around the bishops because he's fundamentally changing the mission of the church, de-Christianizing it, actually. And the bishops, a lot of bishops don't want that at all. Now, it's very, very interesting to look back over the last 40 years, let's say, and we know the Catholic Church has had a lot of scandal, which, and ultimately it's rested on the heads of the bishops as, how come you didn't clean everything up? And the bishops say, hey, it's not that easy. You know, we're a religion of forgiveness. It's a very, very tricky situation involved. That we, once you're a priest, you just cannot throw them out into secular society. You move them somewhere else and try to get them away, and the recidivism is a very big mess, of course, the abuse scandal in the clergy. But it's very interesting that this did more than anything could possibly think of to delegitimize bishops in the eyes of the world. And it just so happens that along comes this anti-pope, whose goal is to change the fundamental mission of Christianity and the Catholic Church, who wants to, in order to do so, has to get around the authority of bishops. Well, guess what? The authority of bishops have been severely undermined. Now, I think a lot of people will smell the rat these last 40 years. Saying, there's something fishy going on here. It seems like a setup. I've always said that it was an intentional attempt to subvert the church, especially the authority of the bishops, and make them look bad. Well, now they look bad, and along comes this pope and says, oh, it's very convenient that the bishops look bad for me because they don't have the power that they used to have in the public opinion, and they'll side with me and not with the bishops. So he goes first to the president, he meets with some bishops here, but he goes to the president first, and then Congress, and then the UN, okay. And to promote his agenda, not so much to the bishops. He came here to kind of see if he could get the American bishops in line, you know, in line with him. But he goes right around them. And the same thing with the president, going right around the people of this country and the Congress by just signing executive orders. What do I want today? Okay, I want this. Okay, I'll just write an executive order. It's the law of the land. Everybody has to follow it. Because my agencies will make sure they do. What about the laws that are on the books that the people want? Well, I don't feel like following those, so I just won't enforce them. I'll just tell my Department of Justice, just don't enforce those laws. Yeah, but it's a felony. They can't. It's a crime. Well, we're just not going to do anything about it. You know, man of lawlessness, to say the least. So you have these two characters on the stage here now, running things, running the global agenda for the next 15 years. So we have to ask ourselves, is this what we want? Is this what we really want? Is there something, some other alternative? And we say here that there is some other alternative. It's the path to we call it many things: enlightenment, self-realization, non-dual abidance, vision of oneness, setting aside our pretense, you go on and on and on, liberation, self-realization, salvation. It's all about ultimately setting all pretense aside, finally. Stop pretending that we're something other than what we really are. That's ultimately the goal. And this is a better agenda, a better way to use our time and our effort and our energy. Way, way better. Now, with this in mind, let us talk about, shift gears a little bit and talk about reaching this goal. And I had some insight into this morning. And I had this dream of this terrible storm that was just horrible, went on and on, this huge waves crashing over a shed that I was in. I talked about that in the previous video. I said, man, there's just got to be a better way than that. You know, that it was just really way too much of an ordeal, horrible ordeal. And then it sort of dawned on me, you know what? I kind of think that I was just imagining all of this. I wonder if I was just imagining all this. I bet I was. This is just 100% my imagination, like a dream. And I don't have to dream this dream of strife and ordeal. I could dream a dream of peace instead. I said, why don't I dream, instead of this horrible weather and storm, why don't I dream of an atmosphere, an environment that is absolutely at peace? I said, well, okay. I started thinking about this. I said, how about if I dream a dream of absolute peace and tranquility that extends in all directions, 360 degree, all directions, like from a sphere, radiating out from a sphere like the light radiates from a sun, and I dream that it extends infinitely. And within this infinite extension of peace, there's not even the tiniest ripple of conflict or opposition or discord or displacement. Okay, I said, okay, great. And there's not even a trace indication that this peace has ever been anything but peace. It's always been perfectly untroubled. Well, I mean, if it's a dream, there's nothing that could make it otherwise if I decide this is what I want to experience, right? It's my choice. Then a subtle issue came up, which is very important. And the issue is, well, would this dream of peace be displacing the dream of strife and ordeal and turbulence? Displacing it? I said, ah, so this is the subtle trick that the mind is stuck on here. Is it really displacement? Well, let's say you're doing an imitation of John Wayne and you start to change and you do imitation of a president or something. Okay, as a celebrity, you're imitating a celebrity. You said, "Let me, an actress or actor, actress," or you say, "Okay, let me shift over. Let me imitate a president or something." Now, is the first imitation being displaced? Is it actually being displaced? I mean, is it still there and you're pushing it like it's there, pushing it off to the side, or is it simply like when you decide to do a different imitation, is the first imitation simply no longer there? It's your choice. Do imitations have some self-existent reality to them that you can talk about displacement and it makes any sense? Let's say I'm pretending I'm Donald Duck, and then I say, well, I think I'm going to pretend that I'm Mickey Mouse. You know, what happened to Donald Duck? You know, did you replace him? Did you throw him in the dumpster? I mean, what happened to Donald Duck? And, you know, we say, nothing happened, you know. I can go back to, just like, return to pure potentiality, which he never left. The potentiality of pretending to be Donald Duck never left the pure realm of pure potentiality. It's just in an unmanifest form, but all unmanifestation is also inherently manifest in its potentiality. So nothing happened to it. So this is the rope and the snake thing. Well, what happened to the snake? Well, I was just pretending that the rope was a snake. So this is the tricky area that's tripping us up. We think, well, if we dream of peace, that displaced the poor old strife has been shoved and crammed into a closet or something. No, it hasn't. It's just like, you know, like we shift our tone of voice. Is something being attacked are destroyed by doing this? Or is it just creativity that is simply playing, choosing to play in this way right now without ever getting rid of the first creativity, the potential to do it? It's still completely there, 100%, in terms of manifest, unmanifest potentiality. I say I want to say letter A, and they say, well, I want to say letter B now. I mean, has letter A been attacked and displaced? But it was never established as a self-existent. How can we talk about displacement? So if this is the trouble I saw in my mind that everyone struggles with, really. We think that we have to displace something. And so we make something that we think we have to displace, evil. We think it's evil. We've got to triumph over it. But nothing has to be displaced. We're free to experience whatever we want to. That's reality. So if displacement was an issue, then we wouldn't be free at all. We say, well, I can't choose another experiencing because that would displace the first one, so I'm imprisoned. By whatever I'm experiencing, I'm totally imprisoned by it. So this is a technical point that is very important. And we're not going to try and solve it right now. It's very important just to be aware of it, just like we're aware of the United Nations. Have to come up with another name for this thing. The biased nation. Biased nations. Repressive nations of the world. So we're just aware of what the agenda is. We're aware of that. Then we're aware we have this. We say, yeah, I could dream of this peace everywhere, as if it's always been there, meaning it's not being caused by anything. This is very important. Non-causative, and let's look at this too. When we say non-causative, if we imagine something, obviously we're causing it, imagination, okay? But it's not being caused by any other factor of imagination, as it were. So other than the primal cause, which is we're imagining it, there isn't any other cause. It's not caused by some dynamic. So when we look at this piece, it seems there's no dynamic that is giving rise to this. We're other than we are imagining there's this infinite peace. Spirit is imagining there's infinite peace. But there's not some machine generating this peace, or there's something being flattened out by this peace. You know, the piece is, you know, pushing something or flattening something or doing something. No, it arises fresh and clean this very instant. Completely fresh and clean and untouched this very instant. This is the very nature of creation. Everything arises fresh and clean every instant, perfectly untouched by any other instant. So it's worth hearing this. Very important to hear it, and we don't need to struggle with it. I can feel that it's just a little struggle, but that's okay. That we're getting there. Let's say that these pictures, photographs on your desk, hard copy photographs, and you'll pick one up, and then you go look at another, and you pick another one up. Well, each time you pick one up, you say, I want to look at this one. Well, the other ones are still there on your desk. You can go back and look into them whenever you want to. They're not being really displaced or thrown away or discarded or anything's happening to them. So if we want to see peace, it's like an image, so to speak, of peace. Experiencing, ultimately we go to experiencing, but let's say we want to experience peace. Well, that's an experience that we're choosing. Infinite peace, calm, tranquility. No strife, no trace of strife. And it's not a negative, just like no trace of strife. It's a positive saying, beautiful, tranquil peace, perfect harmony everywhere. Absolute peace. peace and harmony reigning everywhere. We could choose to experience this just as much as we could choose to experience raging tempest. You know, we're being besieged by a raging tempest. Well, we could choose to imagine this, or we could choose to imagine absolute peace and harmony, tranquility everywhere, as our experiencing. It's just a choice. Neither one is caused at all, except by our own desire to experience it. So outside of our desire to experience something, there is no causative factor whatsoever. So this truth, I can feel it hitting resistance, which is great. This is why we're talking about it. So this is really a very touchy area, no question about it, which is great. That's what you aim for, is to get to those touchy areas where you feel, whoa, you know, this is really, wow. I can feel the consternation there, you know, great. Because we don't realize we're just imagining a place of strife, the world. We don't have to imagine a place of strife. We can imagine a place of absolute peace and harmony. And even this whole world will take on the appearance of that. Jesus said that's how what you'll experience. Because you are in charge of your experiencing. We all are. We don't realize that the world is not causing us to feel the way we feel at all. We're imagining a world of strife and suffering and famine and inequality and all this kind of stuff. The feelings that we're having, spirit is imagining those feelings and blaming it on the world. Blaming it on the world. This is crazy. You mean what we need to do is to stop blaming the world for our suffering? Ultimately, the world's not causing our suffering in the slightest bit. You have to hear this. Nothing but our own choice is causing our suffering. And I don't see the United Nations saying one of the goals is to make this very clear. But it's one of Jesus' goals for sure. Maybe Jesus will come out with 17 goals. Maybe he already has. Just people aren't paying attention. So there's nothing in this world that can make us feel anything at all. Can make us feel anything. What we do is we feel suffering and misery and deprivation, vulnerability, mortality, and we project that as if the world's causing it, where in fact it's not. We could just as easily decide that we're going to feel absolute peace, harmony, and tranquility, and we might think the world is causing that too, but it's not either. It's not. It may seem like, oh my God, the world's so beautiful and peaceful, so, but no, we're actually simply choosing to feel that experience. Now, the good part about choosing this experience is it gets us very close to accepting the equal standing, the perfect standing of all in reality, which is the ultimate goal. So imagining peace and harmony and beauty as you are experiencing gets us very close. This is the intermediate step. It gets us very close to ultimately accepting, you know, what we truly are, what the oneness that all everything truly is, the perfect standing that all truly has. So it has a very pragmaticness to it, you know. It's very pragmatic and helpful. We don't have to do that, but in order to stop pretending we're something we're not, we do have to have this intermediate, you know, we've got to deal with the continuity fear. So we can just imagine that we're experiencing this unalloyed, fresh, clean, no dynamic whatsoever, 100% uncaused other than our own desire for it, peace. Uncaused other than spirit's desire to experience it. Peace and harmony. We can experience this. The world cannot tell us what to feel at all, actually, here. The world can't make us do anything, feel any spirit, cannot make spirit feel any which way at all. Spirit is simply choosing how it feels and then projecting on the world and claiming that it's world that's making the spirit feel this way. In other words, spirit's trying to pretend that it's not what it really is, doesn't have the power that it really has. Denying its own power, denying true causality, denying cause and effect. I mean, trying to reverse cause and effect. By saying the world's making us feel a certain way, as we're trying to reverse cause and effect. I don't see that in the United Nations goal to try to clarify the true nature of what true cause and effect really is. That's not a goal they have there either. It's terrible. Dropping the ball there. Biased nations. Now, it's true, as I back to the United Nations, all the bias, it's true that women tend to be more materialistically oriented because they have to raise the children, and children need simple teaching. You know, they want the child to develop, you know. Okay, so all this abstraction we're talking about here, you know, they say, well, that they can understand this perfect just as well as men can. But they say, well, it's not so pragmatically useful to me because the children don't really understand what I'm saying. If I'm always talking this way, you know, this is not going to be helpful to the children. Well, this is not even necessarily true at all, actually. The children would pick up on it. It's just that the convention in this world is so severe that women feel that they must mentor their children in a way which makes them successful materialists in this world. So therefore they just say, well, this information is not that pragmatically important to me. They don't value it as much. This is the difference. It's not a inequality in the capacity to understand. Absolutely women can understand the same as men and get this. It's that they just don't value it as much because they say, well, it's not that useful for the children. You know, and the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren. So the problem, if there's a problem there, if that's the, you know, the path in life is always to be around children and thinking you have to mentor them, then you're probably not going to pay any attention to this, you know, to truth at all. There's a big problem. Oftentimes women who don't spend a lot of time around children, I've met some, they're very advanced. They've done a, you know, good job for sure. They've made tremendous progress on the spiritual path. Not necessarily more than men at all, but you can tell they've made, you know, tremendous progress. Because they don't have to dumb themselves down. The women think they need to dumb themselves down to mentor children. It's a problem. Which is why a lot of, you know, feminists, non-traditional women, try to, you know, push off their children to nannies in the state. And so they don't have to, you know, dumb themselves down that way. Unfortunately, they tend to pursue academic and power pursuits, secular materialistic pursuits. But, you know, that's one of the things. They don't want to be tied down to dumbing themselves down to constantly raising children because it does have a profound effect. You might become a good child psychologist, but you wouldn't necessarily know anything about salvation. But if a woman, a mother, is actually meditating and doing this, and the child will see that and say, oh, that's what we do in the world. Great. Right? So setting a good example by your own profound encounter with truth, then the children have a great role model to follow in that way. It's just that the state and materialists want the children to be fit right, plug them right in, plug and play, plug and work, you know. And so the mothers think that they need to raise children in that way, which is very, very unfortunate, and it causes them it's very detrimental. Like I said, I agree with a lot of the goals of feminism, which is, you know, don't have children, or don't think you have to be a helicopter mom with your children. You know, let show them, you know, the spiritual side and all this, which was, you know, ideal, but it turned, unfortunately, radical feminism hijacked feminism, because the lust for power and materialistic comforts, and it was just, you know, it was too enticing for so many women. They said, wow, you know, look at the control we can gain and the power we can gain. And it's just like intoxicating, very intoxicating. Whereas the spiritual path seems pretty humdrum and so difficult. But, you know, women are good at multitasking. They can set aside time. They can help their children and then say, okay, you know, and take your nap or whatever. Well, of course, that doesn't always work. And set aside some time for intense focus, intense practice. Absolutely. Absolutely they can. It's just that the lure of the world is very strong here. And it's very difficult. And it's easy to just, you know, say, well, let me go for creature comforts. And they might as well, everybody might as well go for liberation, because let me tell you something. From a man's standpoint, I don't know any men that really like women. They don't really like them at all. And I don't think women really like men. They're not happy at all. They're not happy at all with women. They're not. It's a real pain. And so why are we worried about human relationships as if this is what's supposed to make us happy? Because it's not going to. It's never going to make us happy, human relationships. Because we're not human. And the whole idea, no, we're human, we got to be happy as human. Forget about it. You know, don't worry about whether, you know, men like me or women like me. It doesn't matter. You know, we're going for the vision of oneness, where we realize that we're spirit and we're all perfectly inclusive. When you see that vision of oneness, this is on the level of spirit, and then you feel like absolute love for everyone spiritually, as that they realize they're all just spirit. These corpses that are walking around as bodies, you know, are nothing. It has nothing to do with what we are. So why do we worry about relationships between corpses? It's better just to be pragmatic. You know, the United Nations is way too idealistic. They're crazy idealistic. Idealism is a devastating fault. We should simply accept the pragmatism of the situation, let the Holy Spirit guide our path, and then that's it. That's the end of it. That's the end of it. That's all there is to it. Instead, we pursue these, you know, insane, idealistic, utopian goals here, courtesy of the United Nations, the Pontiff, and the POTUS, and every other world leader in the world, who grossly misled and being very bad shepherds indeed. So, if you know, we'll see what Jesus has to say about all this and what his plan is. But obviously, seeing this, you realize, wow, the Holy Spirit was right to get us to practice, get familiar with spiritual truth, because familiarity is the winning hand. Okay, if you don't have familiarity, now you're going to be pulled back into familiarity. We're always pulled in into what we're familiar with. When we're faced with a difficult, stressful decision, you know, where, oh my gosh, let me find what I'm familiar with, and I'll feel okay then. So, you know, Holy Spirit said, get familiar with truth, get familiar, and then there will come a time, 2:15, I was told, is the year. And right on cue, this is the initiative, the Sustainable Development Goal Initiative 2015. They set it up for 15 years to 2030. This isn't a one-year plan. This is a 15-year plan that the whole globe is signing off on, saying, and this will be taught and put on in the media and the television and all popular culture and the celebrities and the music, every which way you can think of, and the funding. This will all be funneled into these goals. There's a massive funnel, and we're all being funneled into focusing on these goals that the United Nations is putting forth. And this is a spiritual disaster for us, of unprecedented spiritual disaster. Holy Spirit's very aware of it, which is why it's saying, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. You know, don't miss this. You know, it's pressuring me so much. I've just been under so much pressure. You know, I said, wow, maybe I should just get away and play golf or something. This is so intense. Holy Spirit says, no, 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 not right now. Keep working, keep working. This is very important. You have to be aware of this. So now we are. Now we are. It's just a wrong way to go about it. Wrong emphasis, wrong context, and wildly unpragmatic and idealistic. And of course, you know, it's the old thing reaction solution is someone who has an ideological solution will try to develop a reaction that leads right to the solution. So we have this massive, you know, population using resources like crazy, you know, worse than any animals could ever think of, and this is a reaction to that leads us right to this solution. And I've always said the Green Revolution was an intentional buildup of the population and the lifespan of this world, treating so many illnesses and giving long lifespans to so many people in the world, consuming more and more and more and more, et cetera, the resources, which just leads to this reaction like, oh my gosh, you know, we're all doomed, funnels us right into this solution that they had waiting for us. If the world had followed the Holy Spirit, none of this would have happened. So we'll find out, I believe, soon, very soon, what the Holy Spirit has for us. But we stay very, very well informed here without obsessing about trying to dig into everything on the internet. Just the Holy Spirit knows what's important, what's key. This is key here. This is why we're doing a whole video on it. This is very key. Because this is the big one. And they even brag about it. United Nations bragging, but I said, this is the biggest initiative in history. And it is. They're not lying about that. Well, biggest initiative in history is the Holy Spirit. That's for sure. Everything else is nothing in comparison. But in terms of secular initiatives, you say there's the biggest secular initiative in history. The biggest secular initiative in history is going to be formalized during this session of the United Nations. I don't know when they'll formalize it, but you know, I think it's 25th through the 28th or something, or 27th, or you know, it's going to be formalized and signed off on, and we're good to go. Just the beginning of autumn, just as the Holy Spirit told me, you know, beginning of this autumn, look out. This is when it all becomes apparent what's going on. So I asked the Holy Spirit, give me a sign. As I go outside, I said, I want to give me a sign what's going to happen. I need some hope here. And, you know, when are you going to act, et cetera. So I said, the first thing I see, this is going to be it. So I see this old, black, dirty, beat-up pickup truck drive down the street, and I go, yuck. Darkness, terrible. I said, oh, gosh. And then I hear another car revving down the street and say, wait a minute, I don't think this whole thing is over here. Let me at least wait for this other car. And this beautiful white, clean white car came down the road after the beat up old black car, you know, one symbolizing the terrible darkness of the United Nations agenda, the other the beautiful light, bright clean light, freshness of vision of oneness, the vision of peace, the Holy Spirit, the option of what the Holy Spirit has for us, you know, which is to set down pretension, ultimately to take that path. And the Holy Spirit says, you got it? And I said, I got it. Yeah, that the Holy Spirit's agenda is going to follow this one. Once this agenda is, you know, set in place, then the Holy Spirit will come upon the scene and inform us of the another option, an option to this. So it may happen after maybe the 28th or after the this initiative, the Global Sustainable Development Goal Initiative, is signed off on by United Nations. Then the Holy Spirit is going to present its plan, maybe for the next 15 years or whatever. We don't know. maybe a 15-year vacation for us, as I've said. So this is what I was shown. You know, it's pretty easy to interpret this. That truck caught my attention. I said, wow, what a yucky truck. I don't want that at all. And then this beautiful, sleek, white sedan, you know, that was so clean and looked so beautiful, that came next. I said, yeah, oh, I like that car. I like that. And I said, this is how it go. First, the darkness of the United Nations, and then the light of the Holy Spirit. So be of good cheer here. We'll prepare for that. We'll prepare. And, you know, keep getting used to it. Familiarity, familiarity, familiarity wins, 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 wins. If we don't have familiarity, we're not going to win. We're not going to get what we really want. Because unfortunately, we have this severe continuity fear. And this makes us feel like familiarity is safety. Safety. So we have to keep getting used to truth. Because then we'll say, oh, yeah, this feels like safety to me. Even though reason will tell us it's safety, we still want to feel like it's familiar to us also. Because familiarity always feels like safety to us in this pretending that we're doing. Okay, it's really cooling off today. It is a much, much cooler day. Somehow the marine layer expanded. It didn't turn into fog, but it just saturated the air with a coolness. And it's supposed to, what is today, too? Supposed to heat up tomorrow. I don't know how that works. And the next couple of days is supposed to get hotter again. So, actually, I'm going to fire up the barbecue now. And barbecue and onion. They say, put it on heat for barbecue for 20 minutes, and then leave it on high heat for another 40 minutes. I said, what? That's an hour. I'm not going to use an hour of propane to barbecue an onion. That's crazy. I don't know who wrote those instructions. It must have been written in China somewhere. Because that doesn't sound right. I think that's nuts. I'm going to see how long it takes to barbecue an onion all sliced open. I mean, onions cook really fast, actually. So it shouldn't take that long. Anyhow, time to get after that. So wonderful spending some time here with you. This has been really awesome. Don't take any offense at my opinions on the other. You have your, you know, you'll have your own perspective. What's important is that we're looking at this together, you know, looking at this together and recognizing, hey, this is happening. Okay. At least, you know, this is happening. We're being funneled into this 17-point plan, 15-year plan, global initiative, and they keep emphasizing everyone. They emphasize that. It's a mantra to them. Don't think that with the use of technology that they're not going to put the pressure on everyone. Google's committed to pressuring everyone. You know, human, a video. Did I show you that? I didn't. Maybe I didn't show you that. Let me show you this real quickly. I may have. Oh, no, here it is. Okay, let's take a look at this. Because I told you about this before. Google, I never see him promote a movie. Well, here we have. This is the promotion. I took a screenshot of this, and Google had this up. It said, Human, a new film about every single one of us. Watch here. Okay, this preceded this conference. Again, they use terminology, every single one of us, as this is repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated. I don't have that paper I read in the last video, but it goes over and over and over saying everyone, 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 every single one of us, everyone, everyone. They put this in almost every sentence now. Every single one. Tell everyone. This is for every single one of us. Everyone must get involved in this. This is for every single one of us. Everyone, everyone. Human, a film about every single one of us. Watch here. Actually, it's a film about not a single one of us. I gotta fix it for him. A film about not a single one of us. That's what they should have said. They made a mistake. Must have been a typo, I'm sure. Human, a film about not a single one of us. Ah, well, gotta watch that film, huh? Because that's the truth. Not a single one of us is human, but every single one of us is spirit. This is the truth. This is the gospel truth. Even though, remember, our pretense, we're geniuses, complete creative geniuses, and pretending, so it seems like, you know, maybe we are, but we are not. We are not. And the teachers, great teachers, have shown us through their miracles, through their incredible plasticity. They just know it's just an appearance, just an appearance, just an appearance. And we say, oh, how'd you do that? You know, it's just an appearance. They know exactly can appear any appearance as they want to. It's just, it could appear. We're not bound by any appearance. We're spirit. We're free. We're still exactly as God created us to be. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me to be. So we're just in the ballpark here. Each one with slightly different perspectives, okay? Understandable. And so we're in to stay in the ballpark and get familiar with all this. If you don't want to be funneled into this 17-point 15-year plan, and after that funneled even into even narrower and narrower. And of course, this is just starting out. It looks great in the start out, but there's some great nastiness ahead if you don't go along with it, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. As artificial intelligence gets more and more involved, more and more involved. Just look at how much we've changed in the last 15 years since the internet really got cooking. It's been a little, you know, about 15 years, you might say. Well, imagine the next 15 years, how much change is going to happen in this world. If we keep going down this road, right? Yeah, they say, oh yeah, okay, it's real, looks a little nice, nice colors right now, but phew, that funnel gets narrower and narrower and narrower and narrower as you get funneled in. Okay, we know that. All right, so very exciting time. Don't lose faith. I told you the Holy Spirit showed me that it's likely that it will bring make its play after the United Nations made its play. Okay. All right. Just a little bit, very, very, very quickly afterwards, very shortly afterwards. Okay, we won't have to wait long at all. We will not have to wait long at all, but I believe this United Nations thing probably has to get finalized first. So people can't say, well, you don't know if they're going to sign it, you don't really know. Well, but once they do, then we'll say, yeah, they did. And then the Holy Spirit will say, okay, you see, this is what I'm responding to. This is what I've been showing you. Okay, here's the option we have to this. All right? So again, don't lose your faith. Don't anyone, you know, get jittery.